Good evening. Welcome to the September 14th. Thank you. Village Board Work Session. This meeting is now called to order. We're going to begin with the pledge, followed by a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And most of us in the room know that that moment of silence was in honor of Bobby Williams, who was a member of our community that attended more Village Board meetings than probably anyone else in this room, and always had something kind and wise to share with us. And he is very much missed by the members of this community. It's my understanding that there will be a wake at Star Bethlehem this Friday from 6 until 9, and then the homegoing or the funeral the following morning, Saturday at 9 a.m. for anybody who is interested in honoring his life with members of the community. Okay. We have an exciting agenda to get to. I will just thank people for the very high level of engagement that we had in the community already for the past 2 months discussing issues related to housing, most specifically focused around ETPA, the potential for rent stabilization in the community. The public comment period, we had two public meetings where people spoke, and then we had been taking written comments for 2 months, which ended at 4:30 yesterday afternoon. I don't know if we have a final tally of how many people we heard from. I know that the clerk has collected quite a pile, and we've circulated everything among the board members and key members of the staff. Thank you very much for your often thoughtful, candid, and sometimes impassioned opinions that you've shared with us and you want us to take into consideration as we continue through this learning process and deciding how we may move forward with ETPA or not, and how to consider it. We're going to have it on a work session agenda coming up in the coming weeks. The date has not yet been determined. And I do have one community announcement. I don't know if others. I see somebody scrolling through their phone, so I imagine I may be the last to tell people this. Thank you to everyone who joined us at the 9/11 ceremony this Sunday afternoon at the waterfront. It's always a very moving ceremony. I felt that the keynote speaker was a New York Fire Department battalion chief, who's also an Ossining resident. It was really a moving story, and some lovely singing and the presence of so many of our first responders in the community. It was lovely. In this week, on the 15th anniversary of 9/11, the Ossining Documentary and Discussion Series is showing a film called In Our Son's Name, which is the subjects of the film are the parents of a young man who was a victim of 9/11. And their response to it was to seek peace and reconciliation and to find human connection among not just other families who lost loved ones, but much more broadly. And the In Our Son's Name is a reference to a letter that Orlando Rodriguez, the father, wrote soon after his son's death, expressing he did not want more violence to come out of the to result from the horrible tragedy of that day. So that was his reaction, was to, and it eventually became a film about a nonviolent response to a horrible tragedy. And so I hope that you're able to join us. It's at the Ossining Public Library. Seating begins at 6:15 this Thursday evening, whatever Thursday evening is. The 15th, thank you, sir, tomorrow. Okay, could somebody say something cheerful?
I'll jump right in. The Ossining Historic Cemetery's Conservancy
The Ossining Historic Cemeteries Conservancy is hosting an event this Saturday
Tales of the Mysterious Leather Man. Master storyteller Jonathan Kruk is going to be at the Sparta Cemetery, and he'll be telling his tales of the Leather Man. And in addition to that, we're also going to be unveiling an historic marker for the Leather Man. Because of the situation on Revolutionary Road, we're having the parking at Scarborough Presbyterian Church, and we'll have shuttle buses to take you over to the cemetery for the event. It's $10 a person, $20 per family. We ask you that you get to Scarborough Church around 9:30 so we can shuttle everybody over. But I think it's going to be a really great day. The weather looks great, and Jonathan Kruk is certainly very entertaining, and we'll be able to celebrate another legend in Ossining with Tales of the Mysterious Leather Man. Thanks so much.
Interim Manager Fraley.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, Mayor and Board. Our first agenda item this evening is in furtherance of a request received in a letter sent to the Board from Reverend Jones from the Star of Bethlehem. This evening, there's members of the Star of Bethlehem congregation to discuss with the Board the potential honorary street naming of the former Reverend from the Star of Bethlehem, Caulfield, who I will turn back over to the Board to initiate that discussion.
Thank you. we're going to hear tonight from both Deacon Gilchrist, who was the person who sent us the letter some time ago for getting us to start talking about this possibility, and then we're also going to hear from village historian Dana White, who has provided us with some historical context for the Reverend's contributions to the community widely. Deacon Gilchrist, if you would like to join us and just tell us what made you, right here at this podium, please. What prompted you to reach out to us, and if you have any thoughts that can help the community understand what made Reverend Caulfield special and why we would want to do an honorary street naming for him.
Please. To the Village Board, we thank you for what you have allowed us to do tonight, to come forward and speak on some issues. And we thank Star Bethlehem for this privilege to let us come for the church and our 300 members to talk to the Board of Officials of the Village of Austin. We thank you very much. Reverend Caulfield was our leader of our church for 35 years. He did walk the streets in Austin, hospitals, the schools, and prison, and he kept the young folks and the peoples in order. He baptized me at 9 years old, and he ordained me as a deacon of the church at 1971 at Star Bethlehem, 148 Spring Street. And he was an upright man, and he loved to work in the community and the schools. Me and him used to walk all the school hallways, make sure our kids was in order, wasn't sitting around in the bathroom. He spent 35 years in the Village of Austin as a minister, pastor. And he did a lot of wonderful things that had passed over with him that no one knows about. And we grow to love him in Star. And we increased our membership under him. And he was a loving, sweet man, and his family, Sister Caulfield and Woolar. And we loved him so. He left us and went to Buffalo. But we still love him. We invited him back to do different things for us. And he always had time to come to the municipal building and to the police department and talk with the policemen and what can we do to help out. He never went overboard with taking in charge unless he got permission from the chief of police in this town in Austin. And I have some people here with me tonight. Sister Jernigan, she knows just about much as I know about him and everything. I'm going to give away and let her have a few words to say.
Well, you know what? You know what? Actually, we only have a limited time, so I would ask you if you could speak on behalf of the church, and then if we could just have the village historian speak, if we could move this, keep moving it forward, if you don't mind, Deacon.
Fine. Mm-hmm. Fine.
Now I feel terrible.
That was really awkward.
Yeah. Well, that's all right. That was what I said. We only have like.
And also, I was in Stop FM for 71 years. Was a member there for 71 years. And so that means I'm growing older. Yes, yes. And we had a good tenets, good leadership and everything. And he was just like a father to me, a brother, and a leader.
Thank you very much, Deacon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Historian White, if you would come up and just tell us some of the research that you found. Deacon Gilchrist was able to tell us some of his personal experience that may not make it into newspaper clippings, but.
Well, I didn't know him. Different generation. But I did do research into his influence here in Ossining. The Ossining Historical Society Museum, as always, was a great resource. I'm just going to read some of what I've learned, okay? Won't take long. Born in 1911 in North Carolina, Reverend Junius W. Cofield took the helm of Star of Bethlehem in August 1939 when he was 28 years old. In 1973, at age 62, Reverend Cofield left Ossining for the Faith Baptist Church in Buffalo, New York, a post he held until 1980, 3 years before his death. Reverend Cofield gave the best decades of his life to Ossining. In those decades, which aligned with the Great Depression, World War II, and the Civil Rights Movement, he was a spiritual leader, a civic leader, and a soldier for social justice. He was a beacon of the African American community, which has played such a vital role in our village history. Upon his arrival in Ossining, Reverend Cofield wasted no time making his mark. At his first baptism in 1940, he baptized 45 people at once, the single largest baptism in Star of Bethlehem's history. He baptized, over his career there, 715 people in all, dedicated 192 babies, and performed 214 marriage ceremonies. He kept Star solvent and growing, but his influence went beyond Spring Street. He was a lifetime member of the NAACP, president of the Ossining Council of Social Agencies and the Ossining Ministerial Association, and moderator of the Central Hudson Baptist Association. Under Cofield's leadership, IFCA, a bastion of affordable housing here in Ossining, received its first property in 1966 as a donation from Star of Bethlehem. He was a presence in the schools, whether helping to keep the peace during the racial tension of the late 60s and early 70s, or chairing the Courier Memorial Foundation, which offered a scholarship to college-bound Ossining high school students in memory of World War II veterans. He worked with the Police Athletic League to choose 16 local school children to attend a free camp every summer. He was a unifier. He was a healer. He was a leader. The Cofield family was both a product and a shaper of Ossining. Wilma Cofield taught in the local public schools and was active in the church and in the Ossining Children's Center. Their son Willard was born and raised here in Ossining and is a man of the cloth himself. Reverend Cofield did not seek the spotlight. He was not a big man unless you were looking at his determination and spirit. As one congregant put it, with our eyes we see him as a man, slight in stature, but in our hearts and minds we see him as tall, very tall. Cofield himself said on the anniversary of his 30th year at Star, he said, "The people in Ossining are responsible for my staying in one place so long. Their kindness, thoughtfulness, and prayers have driven me closer to God and put humility in my life. If people like Ossining's made up the world, what a beautiful world it would be."
Thank you. Okay. Thank you both very much. So what hasn't been decided is exactly what street we would name and precisely what the name would be. And I think from conversations that I had with Deacon Gilchrist, there were a couple of thoughts. When he was the pastor, it was at the previous location, which was on Spring Street between Broad and James. He lived on Independence Place, so Independence Place was one of the suggestions, but as lovely a little street as Independence Place is, I don't think that many people would see the sign. And I should have brought this to people's attention before we're on TV. I have some thoughts about where it might be. Does anybody else want to say something before I do? What street? Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, carry on.
Well, the deacon and I were talking about, how do we feel about Broad? That block of Broad, where Star Bethlehem has their block parties. It's a very prominent street. It'll be highly visible. Might be nice to have the Reverend's name present on that block.
Talking about Broad Avenue. Sorry, Broad Avenue between Spring and State.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, the flat block. Just there, the primary block.
I think that'd be appropriate. I like that.
I didn't talk to the police department. I don't know if there's any reason that we would need to.
It's a street naming. I don't think there's a enforcement issue on this.
Institutional history that I'm not familiar with. So.
No, my feeling on this is that there's no question we should honor him with a street name, and certainly Broad would be appropriate, and if the folks at Star are good with that, then I think it's a great idea.
Well,
so
yeah,
maybe provide a little detail to your idea, similar to what the village did for Chief Burton. It's honorary, of course, so it is connection with the official name of the road on Spring. So Chief Burton's Way is from Spring, on Main and Spring, to Academy and Spring. So we can do the same thing. And if you notice, Chief Burton's name differs from Peter Falk Way in that it's decorated with the historic signage versus Peter Falk, which is the DOT signage detail for an honorary street name, which is blue and white. Broad or any of those streets around there is a good choice because it is historic district and it has the historic district signage, so we can make historic district signage with Reverend Caulfield's name. I would just ask that because you can have different variations of his name and how it's presented, similar to how Chief Burton says Chief Burton versus Joseph Burton. I would ask that the board and the congregation figure out specifically what they want to call it so we can mock up the sign accordingly, and then I would send that around for you to bless it. No pun intended.
I don't know if we're qualified for that, but
I'll leave that to you.
Members of the church could.
and then we can make the signs and we can hang them on either end of Broad, one at Broad and Spring, and one at Broad and Academy.
We will have to figure out some logistics because
State.
Okay.
State. Broad and Spring has extra signage already, so it's going to be a little tricky, right? Because it doesn't say Spring and Chief Burton Way on it.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
That's further down.
Yeah, that's Academy and Spring Street.
So
yeah.
Oh, you're right. Okay, yeah. I was pushing it further north. Very good. Thank you. Thank you all for reminding me what the map looks like.
It'll work.
Okay. Do we need to determine that right now, or do we want to circulate that by email?
I think email is probably best because
we can put a draft resolution on for next week if you're ready.
Yeah, I think we're ready to do a draft resolution. As far as whether or not we call it Reverend Caulfield Way or Reverend Caulfield Place or
that final name
Reverend
can
Caulfield
be
Boulevard or
added prior to passing the resolution.
If I could digress a little bit, there's also the what's the date of the block party?
October 8th.
I'm not sure the turnaround time on sign fabrication, but if we expedite the official name, maybe we can get something done prior to the block party. We'll see, but I don't make any promises there.
2.5 weeks.
Yeah, depends.
Yes. Deacon?
May I ask a question on this? Too?
Sure. Can you talk into the mic so everybody at home can hear you?
If it's possible, could we add this into our church 126 years this year anniversary?
What do you mean add it into it?
The street.
So what he's asking, for those of you who don't know, I am a member of STAR, is that if it's not ready by October 8th, can it be ready by November
The 6th to the 13th.
Oh, that certainly gives us more time. Yeah. So if that's when you would be hoping to do the unveiling would be the second week in November?
Yes.
Second weekend in November?
Yes.
Well, that probably works better.
Okay, but we'll still push to get the name formalized next week because I wouldn't mind having a little buffer. That would be great.
Perfect. Okay.
Okay.
So we're going to shoot for that then.
I mean, the only thing I would say is if it's on for, I will not be here next week, and I will be disappointed not to vote for it. So I guess that, you know, just saying, I mean, if we're doing it in November, we could also wait till first week of October to do it too, right? So whatever. That's just me being selfish.
The thing is,
I'd
he
like
wants to start
it.
Making the sign.
Right,
so
I know.
We just can't change our minds. Right. Once we pass the resolution, we can't change our minds. So if we haven't passed the resolution, we're not allowed to change our mind once he starts printing the sign.
If it needs to happen next week, then so be it.
And I just would borrow the historian's notes, and that would assist with the drafting of a resolution, if you wouldn't mind.
You're email.
Perfect. Thanks.
Happy? Is that good? All right. So why don't you, yes, sir?
No. Fine.
Why don't you give me a call tomorrow and we'll talk about the exact name. Okay. And then we'll circulate it in an email and we'll finalize everything for next week's meeting. Or maybe not next week's meeting, but maybe next week's meeting. We'll see.
I don't want to hold back the process. So I'm just saying, since I'm not going to be there, I would be disappointed that I cannot vote for it. That's all. Just saying, that's all.
Understood.
There are votes that we make, and some of them you really do them with great joy and enthusiasm, and I would certainly be doing that next week if I was there.
John, you will be us with it in the spirit.
In so spirit, almost definitely in spirit.
Definitely.
Yes.
We will certainly confirm with you when we are voting so that members of the church would know that if they wanted to, they could attend when we are passing the resolution. So we will let you and other members know. So assume it's probably next week, but we'll confirm everything. All right. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We appreciate this from the bottom of our hearts.
Thank you.
This
is the nicest thing we had to talk about all night, so should have saved you for later. Actually, the bridge is fine.
Thank you.
It's not a bad thing. I'll get out of the way.
Yeah, well, if you want to watch it. Yeah.
Thank you.
PowerPoint it.
Very good. Sure.
Oh, yeah. He deserved it.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Oh, we're looking forward to that.
Can I? You want to introduce it, or you want me to introduce?
All right. Thank you so much.
As soon as the room quiets. All right. Interim Manager Fioli, this is an exciting project you brought to us. Looking forward to hearing about it.
Thank you again. As we're loading the PowerPoint presentation to discuss the same, I'm going to introduce it a little bit by telling you that, as you know, and what the public may not know, because we haven't discussed it in some weeks now, there's two behind-the-scenes parallel projects ongoing right now for the two future capital projects that are going to take place at the intersection of Mainspring, Brandreth, and Central, as well as the capital improvement associated with the reconstruction of the Broadway Bridge. By the end of next month, I look forward to bringing you a design update on the options associated with the intersection rehabilitation. That date's to be determined, but I anticipate it at a work session environment in about a month or so. This evening, we're bringing forth a 30% design and pre-design investigation associated with the Broadway Arch Bridge over the Kilbrook. And with us this evening, we have representatives from CalArts Session and WSP Cells. As you know, that's a partnership formed with the engineer who undertook the civil engineering design of our Kilbrook trailway system and utilized the previously existing site work and some of the benchmark work that was done for that project and melded it into this project, which is a rehabilitation of the Broadway Bridge. The Broadway Bridge might be in some people's mind, because previous presentations made by me talked about the DOT and their inspections of the Broadway Bridge, as well as the yellow flag that exists now on the bridge because of its compromised condition. That yellow flag and work that was necessitated during the construction of the Kilbrook Project have brought us to where we are today, which is the total rehabilitation. At the end of this design phase presentation by the consultants, they're also going to include some updated information as far as the potential funding stream for the project, which is potential good news, but I won't steal their fire there. I'll let them discuss it as we get to the end. So in that vein, we have representatives from Kellard Sessions and WSP with us tonight. We have Mr. Joseph Tremelli, who I think you all know because he was the project manager for the Kilbrook Project and is also our engineer with the planning and zoning boards of the village. And he is partnered with Mr. David Weiss, who is the vice president of the structural division of WSP Cells, who's assisting with the structural components of the bridge rehabilitation, and Nicole Shute, who's the project engineer and structural engineer and leading up the design facet of this project, who is also going to do the bulk of the presentation. So, Nicole, I'll turn it over to you now.
Yes, he picked up on that.
Yeah. So,
Why don't you start the first slide?
I'm going to run the PowerPoint presentation. It may or may not have the pictures that I had.
You know, it seems like you have a hard copy. Maybe we could circulate a couple of extras so we can follow along with all the detail, and then perhaps it can be provided electronically later on.
Okay. The rest of the slides are
good. Oh, it looks good. Yeah, we're good, we're good, we're good.
Just the first slide.
There's a couple, but it'll be fine.
We would never know.
These slides are all cramped. They just look bad.
It will be fine. So as Paul introduced this project, it's the lower arch. It's the lower arch of the double arches. So a little bit of history, which I think probably most of you are aware. Old Croton Aqueduct built in 1842. I think they had it was a big reopening in just a few years ago. The Broadway Bridge was built underneath that bridge in 1861, replacing an old wooden bridge. It carries Broadway over the Kill Brook, and it's the lower structure of the double arches. You know, many, many municipal logos use the use that visual. So some of the history of the bridge. Currently, there's a concrete parapet with a steel chain link fence on top of it. Not sure when that was installed. In 93, there were some remedial repairs performed, a lot of bricks replaced, removed. They cleaned and repointed some of the masonry and the stone, the brick masonry and the stone, and they put new screens, new chain link fence on top of the parapet. And then in 2015, when the village was working on the walkway beneath, because of the deterioration underneath, the netting was also put up, just to provide safe passes for anyone going beneath the bridge. It's a brick arch barrel, meaning all the underside elements, if you look up, it's all brick, closed stone masonry spandrel walls, the walls from the arch to the bottom of the concrete parapet, stone masonry. It's about 90 feet in total length, 60 foot span, two travel lanes, one in each direction, one sidewalk on the north side, concrete parapet with chain link fence. So WSP has inspected this bridge before for state DOT. We have contracts with DOT to do biennial bridge inspections. In 2011 and 2013, we inspected this bridge. So when we were brought on to do this work for this bridge, we re-inspected in 2014 in connection with this project. So these are some of the pictures of the worst elements. The fascia, which is the edge of the bridge, a lot of the bricks are missing. They're hollow sounding. The mortar has been fallen out, and there's bricks on the ground. That strip along the edge of the arch belt is about 4 to 5 feet wide. It's all along the length, longitudinally. Above the bridge, you can see the parapet is shifted in some locations, and there's also a gap between the back of sidewalk and the concrete parapet that may indicate that some movement has occurred of the spandrel ball from the arch barrel. With the deterioration, where it is, it's certainly possible. The wing walls at all four corners, there, some dry laid, there's some mortar in there, there's some undermining. It's not in the best condition, but these are the state DOT does biennial bridge inspections. That's every 2 years, state DOT inspects all their bridges. We had history of these years, and so starting as early as 2003, they show some cracking, but then as you move through the inspection cycles, you know, in 2000, it gets progressively worse. In 2011, a yellow flag was issued for increased deterioration. And if this is left untreated, you know, I think it's pretty evident that most likely it's not going to get any better. So we were brought on to look at ways to rehabilitate this bridge. Project objectives: eliminate structural deficiencies, you know, fix the bridge so that it can carry live load and all the dead load of the structure safely, repair the brick and stone, reduce future maintenance costs and concerns, and extend life. And that will be done through the installation of concrete saddle, which you'll see in a couple slides from now. The saddle will act as a waterproofing layer, stops water from entering into the structure and causing bricks to continue to fall out. The saddle also act independently, so service life of 30 years is certainly achievable with that. And these repairs will be done, the saddle will be inside the bridge, so the historic view, you know, the visible parts of the bridge will still remain. And any repairs to the bricks will do, we do it sympathetically. So just again, some of the history of the Broadway Bridge and the Croton Aqueduct above it. In 92, it was awarded National Historic Landmark, so it's a pretty select group. Only 2,500 of the 85,000 places that are on the register are National Historic Landmarks. The Broadway Bridge beneath, DOT commissioned a study in 2002 that said it should be eligible, at least, for the register. It's not listed currently, however. New York State Historic Preservation Office, that's SHPO, a review by them is required for all projects that have federal or state involvement, be that funding or permits or licensing or anything with environmental review. So we still plan to submit this to SHPO as a courtesy to get some input from them as far as historic thoughts on the rehabilitation. This is the saddle. You know, the longitudinal view, it'll go inside on the upper side of the arch, so you won't be able to see it from the bottom. It also goes inside, so in the transverse view, inside the spandrel walls. We plan to extend the saddle, the deck at the top, out 6 inches or so to contain 11-foot travel lanes versus the 10-foot six travel lanes that are there now. That's a standard width for local roads. And the 4-foot sidewalk. Again, the 30-year design life is certainly achievable. And none of this is really visible. You'll see the overhangs, but as you see on the next slide, there used to be, this is an old picture on this postcard, I think, and there used to be a stone cap. So we thought that overhang might replicate that capstone, you know, sort of going back to some of the historical elements. That chain link, or the picket fencing, I don't know when it was removed, replaced with the concrete parapet and fencing, but the picket fencing obviously isn't crash-worthy. You know, a car runs into it, it's not going to stop anything. So at some point they put in the parapet, which is crash-worthy, meaning the car's not going to fall over the bridge once it, an errant vehicle runs into it. So our proposed solution for the parapet fencing is something definitely more aesthetically pleasing and more in line with the historic character of the bridge. This is just some details, CAD details, of what it might look like. There are aesthetic options for color for both the concrete and you can paint the rails, texture, you can put form liners, you can put veneers. type. There are various railing types. The one thing that we do need to maintain is the crashworthiness of it, which can be achieved just through structure. Certainly, whatever we do, I think, will look much nicer and more in historic character than what's there now. As far as the repairs underneath, we need to be careful about how we tell the contractor how to do it. We're going to strictly define what should be removed. We're going to place restrictions on how much he can remove and repair at one time. And then anything that's visible to the public will be repaired using similar grout materials, colors. We had gotten samples, which are out for testing right now, just to make sure that we are or will be matching the proposed repairs. Stone wing walls will fill in all the undermine locations, add a few stones to make them work as they should, and new drainage structures, new pavement, new sidewalk, regular top of roadway stuff. To do this, it's not easily staged to reconstruct an arch, so we plan to do this work under a full closure. The access to the community center will be maintained. The access to for people using the Old Croton Aqueduct will be maintained. Local traffic will still be able to reach their entrances of their driveways, but the bridge will be closed for the length. There's as far as utilities, there's a Con Edison electric set of ducts that runs along the length of the bridge. We're in discussions with them. Gas and the approaches might be affected by excavation, and then there's an overhead line, which I think will remain largely unaffected by construction, communications, and possibly powering some streetlights. So what we've done so far is the survey. We did the top of roadway, conventional survey, topographic, and then this is actually an image of our 3D laser scan. So that's all survey right there. Then it gets processed, and we put the two together, so we have the survey done. Brick and mortar sampling and testing from the arch barrel, that's out to the subconsultant. That result should be available in a few weeks. We took soil borings and rock cores at the approaches to determine rock quality and depth, and a series of probes along the top of the arch because there are no record plans of the structure. So that gave us a better idea of how to model the top of the arch, because since we do know the underside, which leads into the finite element modeling. We use the information we collected from the probes, put in the thickness of the new saddle, model it in the structural analysis program, and that will go into the plans, estimate, specifications for construction that we're working on currently. So what we're doing now, putting the subsurface data into our model, and we now need to figure out what type of bridge railing parapet treatment we will include in the new bridge and work on the construction documents. We're looking at a late September 60% design plan submission, followed by an advanced detailed plan submission about a month later, and a plan specs and estimate submission late November. However, that schedule is based on 100% village funding. Last Friday, we submitted this bridge for funding through New York State DOT as a program, Bridge New York. It's a new program, and they will cover 95% of the cost up to $5 million. And the cost includes design, engineering, right-of-way acquisition and research, the construction cost, and construction inspection cost. They won't pay for anything that has been done thus far, but going forward, it will need to be progressed through the local projects unit in Region 8. So we'll take a little bit more documentation, a little bit more study for them to move the project forward. So we'll have to do some of that if this project is awarded funding under that program. Again, the schedule for advertisement work construction sort of depends on whether this gets selected. Right now, we're moving forward for an early spring, next spring, 2017, contract award they would work through that construction season at a cost about $1.6 to $1.8 million. So are there any questions?
Before we open it up to questions, I just wanted to append a couple of things that, and if I could ask Nicole to go back to the slide that represented the 1861. That one?
Yep.
Okay. That's, we'll call that slide the goal. I know that the Greenway Trail and supplemented by the yellow flags we got from the DOT in the last few years have, you know, and the rehabilitation that the state did on the Old Croton Aqueduct exploited the condition of our arch. And it just, we don't need any more reasons to take on this project. The fact that we got a Bridge New York grant, I think we are a perfect candidate for that. We're discussing it internally with the project team here on the components that would push us to the top of the list of consideration. We fulfill every one of those components, the historical significance, the fact that we started it already because we have a yellow flag, and the fact that it has now a tourism component and a local component and a safety component. So even though we're going to have to bring it up to today's standards, we don't have any intent on doing it with New Jersey barriers and chain link fence, which is the way it was done a couple of decades ago. We want it to look like it deserves to look. This is Village of Ossining symbol. And we plan on making it look as best as it can be. And that's what we're using as our guide right there. So that said, we look forward to good news about the grant, but if we don't, I still strongly suggest we keep proceeding with the project as you've already discussed doing. So thank you in advance, and now we'll open it up to questions. Wait, one more thing. And speaking of the historical significance, when this was first being talked about in concept before we even put this team together, we had, I had separate discussions with HPC, Historic Preservation Committee, on this particular project. And as we approach that 60% design and we start to talk about, you know, true bricks and mortar design considerations, we do plan on reaching out for them and formalizing their input into this project, because they can offer a lot of insight into a lot of the details we have over here. But know this, that the team we have here now is intimate with those requirements through SHPO, and we're making those submittals and right down to the details of what type of mortar we're going to use to work best to represent time period and the arch construction. They've gathered, and she just kind of blew past it pretty quickly in the presentation, but you know, she and her team grabbed the bricks that had fallen and took those to the lab and tested them to see exactly what they were going to work with, because they plan on putting the same bricks back as much as possible. So you're literally going to maintain the 1861 arch and its structural component, and all the details that people will actually see will be 1861. And the enhancements and the things that make it safe and structurally sound will be veiled in the historic structure. So now, questions and answers.
What can we possibly add? You're so excited about this.
Well, you took my questions.
It's no fair. You answer them before we ask. Anybody else?
Yeah, I think, you know, let's go. I mean, we're going to do this anyway. You know, I mean, really, we, because of the yellow status of the bridge, you know, it's from a safety perspective, we have to, and waiting is wrong, because it's just going to deteriorate more and it'll cost us more to repair. So, you know, let's cross our fingers and hope we get the money from the state. Otherwise, we'll have to bond it.
Well, this is already in our capital projects budget.
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we would just take 95% of it out of the capital projects budget, and that would be less debt.
We'll find
debt
somewhere
that can
else
be
to
put
spend the money.
Elsewhere.
Yeah, and it would also, as Nicole pointed out, it'll put a little blip in our milestone date on commencement. But like she also said, we'd look to do that in the off months, so it would go out into next year. But I think fiduciary responsibility would say, yeah, we can wait, because we are only yellow flag. We're not red flag, which would be, they would be closing the bridge on us. But again, with everything going on, particularly in this area with the cultural center being revitalized to assist with the Sing Sing Prison Museum, with the recreation center being right there, and with the Greenway Trail and things going on in downtown, this is a connection, and this should be flaunted for all its value.
And we don't have the museum in the streets plaque yet for the Greenway, so perhaps we can do one and talk about the restoration when we do one, when this is complete.
Yep.
The timeline was all that I was going to add to it, and you just addressed that for us. Again, you're answering all our questions before we ask. Does anybody have any more questions, comments? Well, thank you. This is an iconic project, and we're delighted to have you bring it forward to us in this stage, and we look forward to hearing great news from the grant application.
Nicole, I have a question, because I think you said it, but I might have missed it, so we can just restate it. We anticipate hearing back from the selection committee in November.
They can't hear you at home. It's not us. It's
thank you. Yeah, November is, I think, the time frame the DOT is working around. And they have a commitment that upon selection, they want to see construction commence within 18 months of award. So that's another time element that the state's working around.
Great.
That won't be a problem.
And we'll be ready to do that, obviously, because we'll essentially be, you know, for argument's sake, 90% done with our design submittal. However, one thing we didn't get in too much detail about is if we do get awarded this, there are other administrative layers that we're going to have to do with SHPO, with the state, with different reviews from different entities up there that, again, they'll be paid for through the grant. So it'll be a cog in the wheel as far as the original timeline. But, again, well worth it.
And we would be utilizing much of the work and effort and studies that we've done. It would just roll up into some repackaging for the state. So nothing would be wasted. It would be a good starting point.
Well, we're always pleased to be able to take advantage of grant opportunities when they meet our needs so perfectly. Who was it that brought this to our attention? I'm just wondering who we should pat on the back and thank.
Oh, the team.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The taxpayers thank you, especially if it works out. All right. Mr. Fraley.
Okay, I'm going to let Lori Lee, if you would mind, introduce the next topic with Bill Hamilton.
Sure, I have
to step out for a minute.
Bill Hamilton is here, and Bill and Rika have been working on a subcommittee to overhaul our code of ethics, and we did propose this and brought it to public hearing last week. We did close the public hearing. It is appropriate at this time to deliberate amongst the board and to establish if there are further changes to make in advance of a resolution adopting this as the replacement chapter for your code of ethics. Bill, do you want to come up and do you have any additional words?
Hi.
Hi. Besides hi. This is chapter 17 of the code.
Yep. Yes, thank please. You, sir.
I wasn't there. It's not me on the videotape. Fortunately, what we ended up with was a very straightforward change to what was the existing code. What's reflected in the suggested change, it really has to do with the composition of the board. It was a problem under the – it was always a problem to get any size population large enough to even choose – enough people to man a board. I don't think we ever had more applicants than we had members on the board, to be frank. It was myself, Al Mendez, and Richard Lyons. Richard was easy because he was told to be on the board by the Board of Trustees. So the two people on the board were the two people who actually put applications into the board. What we've done is expanded it to a minimum of five, I believe. I'm sorry if I'm drawing.
Minimum of
five.
It's minimum of no less than three, no more than five.
Right. But the population that the board can request or look to would effectively be any resident within a town or village in the county, which is a population roughly 900,000 people versus 25 or 30,000 here.
But all five couldn't come from outside of Ossining, though?
No.
There's a certain number that can come.
Right, and I don't think that that really would be in the village's interest. I think what the idea was, it's sort of the idea of topping off the pool. We probably have 3 in Ossining. I'm just thinking off the top of my head. And that's fine. You can work with 3. But then if you get into situations with recusals or vacations or any other plethora of reasons why the 3 is no longer a quorum, you can resolve it by having 5 members on the board. And it makes the whole idea of staggering terms certainly much more viable, because now you have 5, not 3. And it even though we're only really talking about 2 additional people, the fact that it's no longer going to be the Corporation Council plus two residents, because in effect, this is what always happened. The Corporation Council, on every single question we had to recuse himself because he was a member of the corporate entity. So effectively, we only ever had a Board of Ethics of 2. And that's, it worked, but it was a real stretch. I mean, it's hard to call yourself a committee with 2 people. It just doesn't seem right. When we go to 5 without a corporate counsel as a member, but certainly as a legal advisor, then you have 5 voting members. And if you have a recusal, fine. You still have a quorum. You can still move forward. The board can make its own. We have policy rules and procedures in place that existed with the old code. They can certainly come back and, based on their experience, develop new rules and procedures to run themselves. I mean, obviously, that's with notice and input from the trustees. 5 would have been a home run. I can't tell you how many times it would have been great to have more than 2 people in the room, just to have more voices, because that's the other. Beauty, I suppose, of being able to go outside Ossining to fill in the body is bringing other voices and other views.
Rika, do you want to comment on it?
No, I think the only other major change is giving more teeth to, I feel like this is this working? Okay.
You're good.
Is giving more teeth. So the purpose of the board is A, to get the right number in the room, B, to cover for what Bill has described. Somebody has to recuse themselves, or somebody doesn't just want to deal with the situation. It just gives you more people. One of the people now does not have to be an attorney, so it adds a citizen element beyond attorneys to sort of bring a different flavor, possibly. The first 3 do have to be village. I mean, that's the core, starts with 3. We've really added 2 more as an opportunity for more people to join in the conversation. For people who want to use the board to simply ask a question before something happens, advice, they don't need to go to all 5. They can go to 1 or 2. There's just more room for play. The other piece is the teeth. You and I called the teeth to the board, and what John Codman and I also discussed, I think, at some length one morning, about the importance of having some ability for the board to subpoena people, to really request that people show up, that there is a little bit more teeth to their
investigative power. Right?
Investigative power is the ability to really take it down the field a little farther than just, hey, do you mind speaking to us? And I think for some people, that'll make the board more potent for them, and a more important reason for them to even join, because it'll say that we actually are giving you some real powers. They do always have to go to the board, by the way, as Bill had explained to me. It's not like they are now becoming new judges in the village. That's not how it works. And it's a nice model to work with, but it gives them a little more empowerment to call people into a room and, with or without attorneys, and explain the situation and come back to the board sort of at certain times and make recommendations that I think are real. So I think we covered the bases on that. Now we just have to fill the board with people.
Yeah, I mean, when we were at the legislative session, wasn't there that there was some item that was going to get added, or Maybe you could refresh my memory on that.
Just a request. Reference, yeah, it's a request to just refer to the statutory authority for removal of elected officials.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, that's all. So it's just a general statement.
Is that in here? Or it's going to be before we vote?
It's going to be before we vote.
There was one other thing that I know we had some emails go back and forth. I'm not seeing it, perhaps it here. Is there a reference in the Code of Ethics to the social media policy? And where are we with the social media policy? Do we need to do something formal to implement it, to pass a resolution saying we accept it as it is, and then it starts getting distributed as part of personnel? It is related to this. That was actually, there were six items that were recommendations from the Board of Ethics from 2 years ago. This is a result of part of that and creating a social media policy, which we have created and we've reviewed, but haven't seen through the process. So can you tell me what do we need to do for that process? And it seems like if we want it to be in any way enforceable, it needs to be referenced in the Code of Ethics, no?
Well, it does need to be a separate procedure brought forward, and certainly the failure to abide by any policy in the village would be a breach. So you can do a general reference to in accordance with all policies.
Does it say that in here?
I'm just suggesting that you could add it.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a separate item, actually. It's not a...
No. But I do remember that conversation.
No, I do too. But go ahead.
Yeah, no, I agree with Victoria that we were going to make, you know, a totally different separate section of our bylaws, but it was going to be referenced on the Code of Ethics itself. Right. You know, if any changes from the it will be just as a reference point of view. So
The thing is, this is actually changing code. So this is more difficult to do. So we don't want to have to change this too often. Social media policy, we're going to have to change 6 months from now
once there's
a new thing. So we want to be able to change policies very easily.
You'll probably be looking at it again.
Yeah, so that's why we wouldn't want to codify the social media policy. We would just want to have it as a formal policy.
They are actually in many ways separate subject matters. That's obvious. We're talking about ethics on one hand, social media on the other. They need to be well-defined separate from one another for a reason. Not every social media violation that may occur is going to be an ethical violation. Not every ethical violation is going to be a social media violation. So what we don't want to do going forward, I'm just trying to think, especially because we do have union employment contracts, if there's a social media violation, the village manager, if I could, Paul, retains jurisdiction through HR on that issue with that employee.
Exactly.
It might just be an informal, hey, don't do that again, here's a letter in your jacket. On the other hand, there is the possibility of the use of social media in the violation of the Code of Ethics. That
could that happen?
But I'm saying, so on one hand, they can absolutely stand alone, and certainly in others, they sometimes mesh.
It actually has a lot more to do with not his employees, but the five of us or our successors.
Well, to make one thing clear, neither the Code of Ethics nor the social media have to specifically say, by the way, if you don't get what I'm saying, I'm including DPW, the building department. It's the corporate entity, which would include, by definition, the Board of Trustees.
But my point is, Paul can reprimand, write up, fire, whatever he needs to do to employee for violating any policy. The only people that we are accountable to is the public. So if it's not cited in the Code of Ethics and it's just a policy, how do you hold accountable violations to the social media policy by elected officials? Because Paul can't write us up.
We had... I'm just trying to think how this goes back 2 years. I had discussions with regard to elected officials and punishment or misconduct, if you want to, and I'm just using that as a very broad term. The Board of Trustees are an elected class. What I meant to say is you're a protected class. There are certain things you can be reprimanded for, you can be removed from office. And that there's where the conversation with the attorney from Albany I was talking to, there's a difference between saying you shouldn't have done that, if you will, the letter of reprimand versus the harshest, which is removal from office. The mechanism for removing elected official in this state is Byzantine, and it's meant to be. If the people elected someone, what we don't want to have happen is some political something happen, and then, you know, we don't want party to party attack each other as individuals. again, the policies have to stand alone as policies to be defined. I had always thought, for efficiency's sake, from the Code of Ethics, and certainly you could do it. You could do it in both. Is cross-reference them?
Yes.
Code of Ethics cross-references to the social media. Social media cross-references back to the Code of Ethics. They don't operate. This, I don't mean to sound like I'm trying to do this on purpose. They don't operate completely independent of each other, but in some ways they do, and they don't always operate together because you can have a violation of one another.
Understood.
When it comes to elected officials, though, it is a different mechanism. You're not, you know, if an elected official in Ossining commits a violation, it is not the village manager who's going to write a letter. It doesn't work that way. The mechanism for elected officials by New York State Constitution is highly complex, and the whole removal process takes over. Short of, quite frankly, removal for a conviction, it has to be for a crime, and that's at the end of that process.
Correct. But we're updating this, we're creating what's going to be a vibrant, wonderfully responsive and thoughtful deliberative body in the Board of Ethics. Right now, there's no language in here, to my knowledge, and correct me if I'm wrong, that references the social media policy. The social media policy should in no way be included in this, in its text, at all, because we want to be able to update that tomorrow without having to update the code. Why do we not want to just make reference to conduct? Why do we not want to make reference to it as a policy that we are expected to abide by? And if we don't, then that's something that should be reviewed by the Board of Ethics if there's a question about our conduct on social media.
Well, you can reference all.
I think Laura Lee said this 20 minutes ago. You can reference
promulgated
the
policies.
Whatever existing social policy, which somehow has been lost in the soup, we're not sure I have to get to you, because it was done, I think, 2-3 months ago, but we have to just finalize it. So you reference existing social policy, and if 6 months from now we change the policy because something new has come up, then that's the policy, right? But the reference should...
We need to find
a space here for that somewhere.
Well, yeah, there's anti-harassment policies,
sexual abuse policies,
vehicle use policies, all the
None
policies.
None of those are referenced here specifically.
Well, I can put a general...
No, that's fine. There's no need to be, because then we can add whatever policies we want to next year.
Correct. We can
they're
put
not
all
referenced.
The...
It yes. isn't,
so what you're saying
say
is, so what it doesn't say here is conduct in violation of any village employment policy.
Yeah.
You can just say that, and then we can add any policies we want to next week.
Right. That is correct.
Without having to change the step, without having to go through.
No, we don't want to change this for a while, but we can add policies every week.
Okay.
Okay. Got it.
We good?
I will do that. And then based upon those two changes, the reference, the statutory reference, the Byzantine statutory reference, plus the cross-reference to, I like that word, thanks, the employment policies of the village, those two changes will be put in, and if you're ready, I can put it on next week for an adoption.
Sounds like a plan.
That's great. Okay. I wouldn't say it's Byzantine so much as it's reflective of the significance of our position as elected officials and the trust that has been placed in us by all the voters that we represent.
The way it went was, he said, are you sitting down? And I said, no. He goes, sit down. This is going to take me a while to get through. When
right.
I sat down and he got done 42 minutes later, because I watched the clock, I was like, wow, that is complicated. It's right yeah. for a reason.
All right.
What did you want to say? No. Did you have your hand up before 2 minutes ago?
It got covered.
Okay.
And if the social media policy is ready and draft, we can circulate it. It needs to go to Labor
okay,
Council.
Okay, then I received an email that it now has to go through.
It has to go to Labor Council.
I realized.
To review for any constitutional violations of free speech. He makes a pass at all of our employment policies. Plus, we'll need to review it just for his opinion as to whether it's a mandatory negotiable item under the CSEA contract. So those are two small steps, and that could be handled with one or two emails.
Who I don't believe saw the draft because, you know, we just recently had it sent out. I just had it recently sent to me.
Sent it out in March to Abe Zambrano.
Okay.
So not recent. It was a part of the social media
I
committee that went through that.
But nonetheless, I don't
believe
it.
But we need to go. Also, you should note that it's very similar to the police department one, and I don't know if there's a relationship because the different attorneys handle that. But it's a copy of what was approved for the And I don't know if that's related to anything, but we don't want to...
They're very different rules for police departments under the state. Yeah, under state statute, different rules. So
that makes it easier, actually. Otherwise, now we got to step back into what they did at the same time.
Yeah.
Okay.
No problem.
Just so I understand, code of ethics applies to the police as well, though.
Everybody.
Mm-hmm. So if there's a policy that's in place...
No, I'm saying
social media.
The adoption of a social media policy for the police department, as it's been explained to me by Labor Council, is a completely different entity.
Yeah, they're allowed to do that if they want. But if we adopt something, it doesn't say not police. They're just covered by it.
Frankly, this is always an open question. The police department, we all know, is a part of the corporate entity. The corporate entity makes decisions on behalf of all employees, whoever they may be. If it's accepted practice that each department, and I frankly would get nervous here, each department would develop its own policy on any particular matter, from the corporate point of view, that's a nightmare. Most corporations have single HR departments, single compliance officers for a reason. All parts of the entity have to be playing with the same set of rules for continuity's sake, and if I suppose at the end of the day, liability. Did all employees get the proper notification as to what the rules are? And maybe the simpler fix is if the police department social media policy is deemed to be acceptable and is adopted by the corporation, then it's not the police department social media policy, it's the Village of Austin social media policy on behalf of all employees.
I was just referring to the fact that it didn't need to go through the same level of review, and there's no reason to have to ask the PBA whether it's a negotiable
item. I'm not touching on the union part, but I'm talking
about I was just talking about the union.
The corporate entity looks down, and I don't mean this in a negative way, but looks down to its employees in the sense of making policy. You wouldn't have DPW writing its own social media policy. You wouldn't expect them to. We don't want them to. We don't want really any subdivision of the entity making decisions, because the corporate entity is bound by those policies that are in place. So if there's a flaw in that social media policy, and somebody puts a complaint in or there's litigation on it, you know, DPW doesn't go hire its own lawyer and defend itself. The corporate entity.
Okay, so, Paul, you wanted to say something, but then I'll get back to that. But you didn't?
I will. Yeah, okay. I think that we need to then follow up with the discussion, because I believe the police have already implemented their own policy.
Yep.
And what I wanted to continue to say with regard to my receipt of the policy, just as the other policies that are in place now are being developed now, they're typically reviewed by human resources, which I also don't believe reviewed the social media policy or has received it yet. And, you know, these things need to be done through that fashion with the union and their contributions to the review as well. And then they go back to you for final concurrence and implementation.
Well, this is an important procedural process for us to understand. But it's different. The police putting forth their own social media policy, that wasn't passed by resolution of the village board who represents the community. That's a department head saying, this is what I want, how I want you guys to behave our department. I mean, DPW could have a policy on, you know, how you handle the trucks at the end of the shift. Like it's a departmental policy. They do a lot of social media communications in their department, so it's not surprising they addressed it. But the fact is, this social media policy is like 95% the exact same words that are already in place in the police department, because we used their social media policy.
It's exactly.
And we like changed some titles and words
eight
and
words.
Punctuation. It's like almost the exact same thing. So functionally, it's not going to be a problem, unless it goes through these iterations that we're talking about and Labor Council looks at it and makes some changes that PBA is going to have issue with. So they probably should be in this, because if it's a union review, then their union should review.
Functionally, whatever the policy is going to be on the day that you guys make it the policy, when you have the vote and select the social media policy, in effect, what you've done is that is a social media policy for the police department.
Yeah.
It could be completely different. It might be exactly the same. But the critical part here is then the police department or DPW or HR can't then 6 months from now say, you know what, I'm not happy with this provision in our social media policy. I'm going to change it, distribute it within that subgroup. That's the whole point. Excuse me. That can't happen. Only the entity makes decisions at that level. And only it has to be controlled. And we have, I don't know how many different unions are involved in the village, We can't have different work rules that way, especially on something like social media.
We have two unions.
Yeah, I mean, okay. the best case scenario, because the idea when we sat in the committee, in the social media committee, was take something that exists and passed by some attorneys, may not be the ones we're going to go to, and it works, and we all looked at it, is the ideal scenario would be easy if, hey, pretty good, a couple of words, and it works. The worst case scenario is, this is awful. It doesn't work at all. We totally have to redo it. We now have to go back to one of our departments and say, the larger entity doesn't agree that what you did actually passes the litmus test, right? I mean, those are the two. They'll either, like on day one, say, yeah, this is great. This is good. It's workable for everybody. This now becomes our policy, our meaning everyone, or worst case scenario, absolutely doesn't work. It's got to be redone. Here's why. Here's what. Then it sounds like you got to go back. I don't need to use names, police, DP, it doesn't matter who, to the department. Say, we understand that it passed muster with you. It just doesn't. From a larger macro point of view, now we got to sit down and figure this out.
Is that right?
Is that what we're doing?
I think
here?
That's correct. And
okay.
it has to be rolled out in a structured fashion. Because just writing a policy and being handed out is not how it works.
Absolutely right.
You have to be trained on the policy. You have to sign off that you accepted the policy. There has to be documentation of that acceptance.
Right.
And it has to be renewed, refreshed, and implemented for everybody new
every year.
Just like we do with our existing policies now. Because if it's not, and you go to issue discipline or termination based on the policy, you will lose.
So let's talk about the two pieces. One is the code is this, which actually states that this will be distributed to everybody getting hired, and it says it in here. Just to be clear, though, it does not, even though our HR department says it has to be on paper and signed, that actually is not the way many places do it anymore. They do it via email and via reply emails to save not only on paper but a lot of work, but I think that's up to you guys how you want to do that. But there's that piece. Then there's the policy piece. Are you suggesting that we cannot distribute the code of ethics piece until the social media piece is ready so that it's done together? Or are you simply suggesting that in both cases, really, both in the code and in the singular policy for now, social media policy, each time there has to be some training, some explanation, signature of receipt, an understanding of the meaning?
Yeah, that was the first thing I was going to say when I held my glasses up was that.
That's fair.
Know, talking about melding of the two, it's really two separate and distinct things.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think, just to summarize here, I think, I think the ethics policy, we're good.
Ethics code, yeah.
Ethics code is fine. I think we can do that.
Great.
It sounds like there has to be some minor reconciliation with the ethics policy because it sounds like the police department already has
a social media policy.
The social media policy. I'm sorry.
Right.
Yeah. So,
and this is the first that I've learned that the what the steps are going to be for the social media policy. So thank you for enlightening us on that. And Rika said, it was March when we finished the documentation.
I think you were in the meeting too. Yeah,
I was.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that we're finally moving it forward. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
This is exciting.
The next item on the agenda is a continuing discussion on the village's Chapter 225 of the Solid Waste Code.
No.
I'm sorry?
No, I said, oh, yeah.
Oh.
Sorry.
I said no. So, again, I'm going to turn it over to Lori Lee to discuss what's transpired since she last presented.
Yep.
We'll go from there.
Thank you. I do have a couple of extra hard copies. Changes were made this afternoon I sent it out, but there were some changes made before I sent it out to everyone late this afternoon because I'd received some more materials today from a member of the CSEA who was tasked with it. So as an overview, we started the process by trying to look at the ability to enter the notion of strict liability into our littering and property maintenance code types of allegations and violations, and it morphed into a larger task, which I took on quite happily to be sure that every aspect of our solid waste regulations in the code right now, Chapter 225, are in keeping with current regulations, laws, recommendations, and actual on-the-ground experience from our sanitation department. So we've taken a lot of time to take a look at new definitions. We've taken some time to look at providing for enforcement, and we've expanded the area in the back on penalties for offenses, and they're ongoing. Both Bill and Lynn have been part of the dialogue. We did have a internal meeting on Monday, and thank Paul for facilitating his guys to come over and spend a good 2 hours with us going through the Article 2, which is that article on trash collection itself. So if you want to start from the top, you can see anything underlined has been added and amended. We've gone through to be sure that we've defined under the new programs the organic yard waste, because that it obviously was something that's now collected separately since the code has been revised. We've defined litter to be very broad, to include items that are discarded.
Either. Are we allowed to ask a question, or do we wait till the end?
Sure, no, you can ask a question as we're going.
The definition, are you with the front yard? There's like the definitions part?
Yes, that wasn't
yard,
changed.
The unoccupied ground area, do all these organic gardens and stuff that are being put, is that considered still unoccupied, even though people are putting in gardens in their front lawns? Which
yes.
I'm a big proponent of, by the way, but I just don't know. It doesn't seem unoccupied if you have something, right? So, but that's okay.
We
like,
can
you know those big gardens with
the plants count as being occupied, you mean?
No.
Or raised beds?
Because you're actually growing something, and I think that's actually different. I don't mean to be weird. I'm just like,
no,
first
I didn't.
Of all, I didn't even, I mean,
the
I
definition
didn't even know
hasn't,
there was a definition for garbage until today, so I don't know.
The definition hasn't changed at all, so okay. If you'd like to add, this is the point where
people are increasingly using their front yards for not, I guess it could be considered a plant, but for all those gardening and all that stuff, so they're allowed to do that, and are they allowed to put those poles with solar panels in their front yard or not if it's supposed to be unoccupied?
Solar panels are a whole nother ball
game. That's a whole different thing.
But
I'm just trying to understand the word unoccupied,
okay.
Frankly, in the front yards.
Well, I think when I think of unoccupied, it's the absence of a structure.
Absence of
structure.
Thus my questions.
that's the way I
okay.
would define it, but it's not clearly.
Okay.
Well, I mean, not to belabor this too much, but
and
fountains,
of course, and we will.
Sculptures, archways, trellises. To me, that's still all part of your front yard. Nobody's living there. It's not a shed. It's
I
not
see.
A garage.
Okay, so a sculpture. Yeah, you're right. That's also.
It's stuff, but.
Stuff, yeah. All right.
So would you like to add some?
Well, I don't know if it's necessary.
No,
I don't know if we're beating a dead horse here. I just don't know how this works.
That's the purpose of this.
Lori Lee, if I may. And, you know, with Bill and Lynn and Joe and the guys from sanitation that sat down with us, the mantra here, so we know as we go through these additions, was to take an existing code that made it very it made it very easy, even if we did try to take that existing code
mm-hmm.
and start to issue
mm-hmm.
tickets or violations for the same, it made it very easy to navigate out of paying the fine because it was too vague. So even though she's in the process of making it extremely specific
right.
And you might look at it at first blush as this is really over the top with details. The details are there for a reason because the devil's in the details. And when we do write a ticket, we want to collect on that ticket. And when we write a progressive fine, we want to collect progressive fines because they're defined. And as she gets into all that, you're going to see the method behind the madness
okay.
and the way it's written is to make it ironclad. So we're not just spinning our wheels before we go out there on a ticket writing campaign when this eventually sets forth. And if I may, again, Lori Lee, before you keep going, we always talk about with the guys, particularly with the OOPS stickers and what you do and don't collect.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless of what this says, there's always going to be, no matter in any village business, not just DPW business, there's always the discretion that's given to the people in the field on what they do and what they don't do with regard as enforcement, collection, operation. It's never slanted. It's never one-sided. But there is always the component of discretion that the people that work for the village exercise in here and in the field. So I don't want this to make it look like we're trying to create a very rigid and, you know, unyielding environment. But at the same time, for the repeat offenders who don't have any consideration for their neighbors or the code, this is who it's designed for. Sorry, Laurie Lee, for that digression.
No, that's not a digression at all. That is the goal and the aim of the process that we're going through. So, okay, so the definition of litter has been broadened to include anything, you know, waste material thrown or deposited, which could create a danger to the public health, safety, and welfare, or if it's a blight. The organic yard waste, as I've said, didn't exist in the other code, and now that's collected separately, so there needed to be provision for that. We clearly defined owner and the term person. Recycling recyclables, back when this chapter was promulgated, there weren't clear guidelines, and the Westchester County hadn't promulgated its source separation laws. So now the source separation law is referenced sort of throughout the document itself completely. And the term rubbish is defined in here. And I was reminded by Mr. Perry of the Sanitation Department that's traditionally known as the bulk collection that's done now along with the garbage collection. And so we made that clear in here, so there's no confusion as to what that means. And then we also broaden the definition of the word superintendent, because back in the day, Superintendent of Public Works was a title we used. Now we've broadened that to include that being the individual designated by the village manager as the head of the Department of Public Works. And also we've allowed that to be a designee duly authorized by either the superintendent or the village manager. So and you'll see that's relevant later in the enforcement area, because we want to be able to broaden the list of people that would be able to participate in the enforcement of
Well, you need to start using designated by throughout everything that we do, because if we outsource mm-hmm. to contractors and mm-hmm. give them and empower them contractually, then that has to be a part of the deal.
Yeah, it's catch-all. We haven't had a superintendent in the village in 20 years.
Yeah. Chris Soy is a superintendent, isn't he?
So we haven't had a superintendent of public works.
Yeah.
Andy's a superintendent.
And then we've done a series of cross-referencing and moving on through 225.3.4 and 225.5. The meat of this is in 225-5, maintaining properties and sidewalks free of refuse, etc. You can see we've broadened by adding section B, that the owner of the property is the strictly liable entity to keep the premises free of litter. And if you recall, we broadened that definition of litter to include all other categories of garbage. So it is ultimately the responsibility of the owner of the property who then can insist upon the occupants and users and tenants of the property to maintain it in this fashion. Yes.
Sure.
Yep.
Owner. So all this zombie properties, I'm not going to read this whole thing, but do you feel now the banks are included in this owner definition? The zombie properties that we have running around and some of the other stuff that we have out there when people walk away from properties, and really the banks are holding and,
yes,
in my opinion, not maintaining as an owner should. So does this cover them as owners, the banks that own?
If they own the property, yes, they would be ultimately responsible. I have actually done a fair amount of research on the zombie property law, and we can talk about that at another time, but I did have some ideas about bringing forward.
Because that law just changed, I thought, a few months ago,
yep,
now in mm-hmm. New York.
Okay. Yeah.
So the definition of owner, which you referenced, but the individual or business entity or organization having title to a building,
yep,
or real property. So whoever holds the title. So that could be a tank, right? Because it's organization and business.
Yeah, that's why I asked, because it's never, that's why they've changed the laws about the zombie, because it isn't clear, and the banks argue differently. So I don't want to have that conversation now. I'm just asking Laura Lee if she feels that this covers those issues of the banks. And
the banks don't take title?
At the end of the process, that's the dispute, the banks wait until the last possible minute.
Yeah.
But that's part of the definition as well, sure, on the owner. That's what you have right there. It says organizations, business, entire. I mean, I think that covers under the definition as well.
That's my question. She understands because we're not going to have the. I just want to make sure that the changes are included, because it may be clear to those humans up here sitting here, but it is not.
We're not talking about common sense. We're talking about state law.
Just like co-op owners argue they're not really owners. They own shares. They don't own real estate. They can walk away and somebody else owns it. And if there's not the right percentage, I mean, there are a lot of discussions about this.
Right.
So I'm asking Lori Lee if she feels this covers the zombie regulate, because we have those properties right now in Ossining.
Yes, we do.
And they're in decrepit and awful condition. And if you feel this covers owner, I'm really happy, because
this covers,
you can then go after them a little bit more.
This covers the zombie properties who may be, the properties who may be affected by the deposit or the allowance to have deposited junk. So
what's happening, yes. Yeah.
So a zombie property has a bunch of junk out front. We can write a violation, and the entity responsible is the bank.
If the bank is the title owner, but I'm going to check based upon the conversation that I'm using the exact language from the new statute.
This is all I'm bringing to your attention. Great. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so this might change modestly if we need to.
I'm impressed that you did this. I'm simply bringing that so that we understand.
I think it's a great suggestion. Okay, and I think if I could mirror the actual language from the statute
in the definition.
Great.
Thank you.
I would like to do that.
Yeah.
And the fact that you can define a person,
Do we have on our code, do we have any other areas where we cover definitions?
Definitions? Yes, we have definitions in many areas.
In different areas, different sections of the code. Now,
and we also have a general section at the beginning that says if the his is used, her.
Correct.
Yeah,
so
gender.
What I was going is, if we define owner under this section, whatever else we have, the same definition as owner, as a front yard or as a side yard or a lot line in here. So I want to make sure that when we make this change, all the changes will reflect as well. Or do we have to do something else to pass that?
That's a good question. If I'm reading
in one section of this and this section, definition of building is here, and I'm reading another section, it's totally different, will that be contradictory to what we're doing?
No, because it's per chapter, unless you have a definition section at the beginning of your code that says building, if you use the term building anywhere in your code, this is what it's defined as, which we don't have.
What about front yard? We have
Front yard is defined in your zoning code.
But it's also defined in here.
Correct. I think they match.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. Oh, definition of owner.
If they don't, somebody should go back and match them.
Correct.
I think what you're saying.
Correct.
Okay, but I think you're saying they should match, and if they don't, and we're approving this, somebody should go back and look at some other things.
Right.
But if
the definition of owner changes here because we're updating it now after New York State set that new regulation, we want to make sure that owner is properly defined in any of the property maintenance codes, which are going to be handled by the building department instead of sanitation.
Yes.
That's what they'll do. More homework.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I put it down.
Yeah. Yeah. No.
Thanks. That's the absolute purpose of this. So that's great. And you can see on the next page. This is the section where we're mirroring the regulations from New York City, whereby you are responsible for that area of the public sidewalk into the gutter in front of your property. So this section is the section that's going to catch up all of the problems with the downtown business district that may exist, also any problems with people allowing things to accumulate even in the non-downtown area. So this catches up that area of the code, and it's also mirrored on the New York City regulations.
We were formally, before this was enacted, we have been caught in the quagmire of, well, you didn't see him put it there.
Yep.
It's really, it's mm-hmm. in the right of way.
This is somebody else put it there.
And a myriad of
mine.
Things. Like, I didn't put it there. I know I own the house, but I didn't put that box spring there.
Yeah.
And now it's a moot point.
And now
point.
It's your responsibility
if it fronts your parcel mm-hmm. all the way out to the gutter.
Right.
You can be ticketed.
So this catches
can I
up.
I ask a human question, though, in that scenario? Because I think I see, as I read more and more of this, I am actually envisioning exactly what you're trying to solve for. I can actually see the scenarios coming to life. But the humanistic side. So I was away for the weekend. I come home. I see somebody dump their mattresses in front of my property. And I'm probably the guy next door, but I don't know that for a fact. Before I get ticketed and before I get summons and before I get in trouble, is there a place I can call and say, hey, somebody just put this there. Can you remove it? Or
again,
is that like doable or is that just, hey, you're responsible. You got to get rid of it.
I'm going to go back to my earlier digression when I talked about the mantra. It's discretion. And
okay.
on these isolated incidents,
okay.
There's no one more intimate with the problem areas than the sanitation foreman.
Got it.
Drives around all day and this is what he does. And he knows the problem. And the troublemakers, and they exist, and they continue to exist because of the lack of teeth that exists right now in 225. That's what this is being done
Got
for.
It.
And actually, later in the code, it clearly states that you can make arrangements by calling and providing the information that somebody put a mattress in my front yard. Can you come and get it?
And the OOP stickers are not going to go away. That's
we understand.
That's an educational tool that we continue to use in English and Spanish. That is, he puts them out there every day to try to educate the.
But after the second time, that will not be affected anymore. After these resolutions and we get some fines out there, hopefully people.
That's the theory.
That's the idea.
Yes.
And are there any other languages that we need? I just am curious if we've gotten complaints about other languages. I mean, we always talk English and Spanish.
We have not. I could just, you know, from my very limited knowledge, helping my kids study Spanish 1 and 2 and everything. It kind of covers it. They're close enough where the check boxes are simple enough where.
No. I mean, have you had requests like people say, you know, have we had different immigration issues where people don't like?
Well, that's
Korean,
what I mean. Most
Chinese,
even the Spanish and the English is so clear and the words are so.
So
basic
okay.
that they can cover it, and we have had not been contested.
We don't have a large Chinese population right now.
Well, Tarrytown's
not yet.
Having a buildup.
Yeah, we could,
yeah.
And then we would add that language.
And then we would add. Yeah, I'm just curious. I don't know.
Okay, we've reached Article 2. This is the article that we received a lot of recommendations from the boots on the ground, as it were, and you can see the first evidence of that. In 225-10, which talks about the receptacle specifications. We drew on a lot of resources for this. We drew on some regulations from some nearby entities, and we also took a look with the help of the head of the CSEA. He provided me with the Federal Code of Regulations, which has very definitive suggestions for the kind of receptacles you should be lifting and using.
Okay.
So it's this used to be, you know, galvanized metal. That was all that was allowed. You know what I'm saying? So it's taken this long for us to catch up with reality, and we're just calling it leak-proof and constructed of corrosion-resistant metal or other material. We don't want it to be absorbing liquids, which makes it heavier, makes it sort of a nuisance sanitation-wise. And also, we've said, in accordance with the federal code, which suggests that it be no more than 35 gallons in capacity and shall not contain more than 75 pounds when filled to the top of the receptacle. So there'll have to be an investment, of course, by the village with a calibrated scale, which will be available for this enforcement. If we're going to claim that something is heavier than 75 pounds, we'll need to allege that by personal observation. So much like we have a calibrated noise instrument used by the police department, we should have this kind of scale portable available. We can't be out there using bathroom scales to determine the weight of
I was going to suggest that Bath and Beyond, but
if we're
not.
If we're going to write the code for the weight clearly we'll need to talk about that as we move forward through the process.
So you changed from 30 gallons to 35 gallons?
Yes, because most receptacles now are 32, so we wanted to say
green ones that
up
are
to
the
35.
Most common ones are 32.
Let me just give a little more field input into that. Actually, most receptacles out there these days are more like 40.
64.
No,
the big wheelie ones?
Well, no, the wheelie ones are like 50. Up 50, 55, and most of them are, you know, between the 35 to 45 range, typical residential can. This is one of those discretionary things. Mm-hmm. Some people have them because of the ease and maneuverability, mm-hmm. but they only load it with one or two bags, right? But some people take the 32-gallon one and pack it with dead weight, where you can't lift it. It's a repeated thing. This is what we want to have in place to go after the person who repeatedly does that. We do not anticipate ticket writing for isolated incidents. We really don't. We anticipate an oops sticker. This is too heavy to pick up. Please address it. Or the guys will manage how to get rid of it that one day after a knock on the door and saying, listen, please, we took it today, but we're not going to continue to take it. That's the goal here. It's customer service. It's not a revenue generating stream. It's customer service. That's what this code is going to help us do.
Okay, and if you look at 22511, it used to be called branches, limbs, and cuttings. Now we're calling it organic yard waste because that's a consistent term that's used, you know, in our IMA, in our annual newsletter. So we're calling it that. We're allowing for it used to be you had to just bind them in twine. Now we're recognizing that they can be placed in open containers. We're also recognizing that they can be placed legitimately in 30-gallon biodegradable paper bags, which again is reflected in your annual newsletter. It specifically says a 30-gallon biodegradable paper bag. So we're just making it reflect reality. And then just to make it clear, we're not saying that you have to take organic yard waste out to the curb. We're saying that it's not to be construed to prohibit private composting of garden and yard waste and on your own private property, which is something that's good because I have a mulch barrel on my own property. And we have a cross-reference here to Chapter 248, which has to do with your tree removal. We want to make sure it's clear in every way possible that people are trying to comprehensively look at the law. Now we have boxes and cartons. That's that's actually a suggestion from the DPW folks. They said that in some cases it's okay to break down the cardboard boxes and place them in another box that's ready to be recycled. So I added that language as a result of their suggestion. And then we had this 22513 section, which made no sense. It talked about rags and similar dry waste, which is clearly covered in other provisions in the code. So this is the section on paper and had to do with shredded paper, reminding people that if you're going to put shredded paper out or paper that's gone through a shredding process of some kind, that you're to put that out with your paper recycling and not to put it in a plastic bag. So we made that clear. That was a suggestion again by DPW, and we were happy to put it in there. On 22514, we simply moved to the last sentence that talked about the failure to provide if you fail to act, we can act. We moved that to the enforcement Article 3. So it's not been eliminated. It's just been moved to a more appropriate location. This next section, B, has to do with a special dumpster service. And in many cases, there are businesses that are putting out an abundance of refuse on collection day when really the more appropriate process would be for them to enter into a dumpster arrangement with the village. So this adds that discretion for Paul, again, if it's appropriate for the property. And that's part of the analysis that that Paul does on a routine basis. So that allows for that discretion. And to remind you that this is a definitive time frame suggested by actually Deputy Corporation Counsel Hamilton, that we need to have a defined volume, which would sort of throw you into the, we need to look at this. So he suggested two or more. If you produce a volume of garbage that exceeds the collection maximum on two or more scheduled collection days in a 30-day period. So again, the foreman goes around on a regular basis and keeps track of this kind of thing. He has photos of pretty egregious violations of this kind of thing. So we're going to be able to talk to those folks and see if we can bring them on board.
Just
John.
I guess in Article 2, or I guess you've got the, in 225.14,
mm-hmm.
B2, and you're saying any property which produces volume of garbage, two or more scheduled collections. And that's, I want to understand what's changing here. It says, or would require more than 5 35-gallon receptacles containing not more than 50 or 75 pounds.
75. Yeah, because we've changed the rule. It needs to be internally consistent. 50 was the wrong number.
Oh, okay.
So then when you do 5 35-gallon times 75 pounds.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So that's what we're doing. Anything underlined is new. And in brackets, we're removing. And then today's, with today's assistance from Mike Perry, who brought me the information on the resource recovery facility at Charles Point, he brought me the regulations there. We expanded this section just to give samples and examples of those kinds of things that you shouldn't be putting in your regular trash. And, you know, more often these renewable batteries contain elements that create a hazardous condition, and they're not, they should not be put out in household garbage. They have to be collected separately as hazardous waste, and we listed the lithium, and I know the lithium batteries have been in the news lately, so it's good to just point that out.
What is the best way to dispose of it?
Our newsletter gives and our website gives details on the Westchester.
There are places to take them to, I think.
Yes, they have to be. They have to be separated, source separated. Yeah.
It's been going on for years. People just don't do it. It's really bad for the environment. Yeah. I mean, Staples, a lot of places collect them.
Yes.
Some give you, like, money for them.
And then item three, we, again, cross-referencing. We are specifically talking about the Westchester County Source Separation Law and the regulations. And they also promulgate guidelines and publish them themselves. So we're providing that just as a reminder about the source separation requirements. The rubbish, this is where we're going back to bulk pickup items. And we're talking about, this was a specific suggestion by the guys at sanitation. We wanted to make it visually, give a visual reference to people who are putting out bulk trash on the curb. It should not exceed 8 feet in length on your curb. It should not be more than 3 feet high or 2 feet deep. And that is the equivalent to about 1.5 cubic yards. So we're trying to limit the people.
Like a couch?
Well, I want to expand on the derivative of that calculation. Ossining, because of the community and what's happened and the housing and the downtown, particularly, it would be short-sighted to eliminate bulk collection. Right now, most communities in Westchester have very specific dates for bulk collection. Where I live, we have 4 bulk collections every year where you can throw out things like couches and white metal waste, et cetera, 4 times per year on a designated day, and everybody loads the front of their yard with all their bulk. Ossining has bulk collection every week, 52 weeks a year. And it's amazing to me how it continues to generate. So these rules are hopefully going to temper that, because I think to some extent Ossining has become an option for a lot of people to get rid of bulk collection. And outside of, you know, where it may be generated. So they might be taking advantage of Austin's very...
I mean, people from your community are driving their couches to Austin and putting them on our sidewalks?
Well, people that own multiple
between
parties.
Between those four times a year?
Edit that out might. Later.
It's people who might own multiple properties.
So, again, in the service business, we don't want to discount that, particularly in a lot of the multifamilies. We don't want to get rid of that option to get rid of bulk waste if there's a lot of turnover in a lot of these houses, and that's where a lot of this gets generated, with i.e. the mattresses, the furniture, and things that you typically get rid of if someone's moving out of a place and the new people are moving in. We don't want to get rid of that. What we want to get rid of is the turnover that generates every month an entire contents of a house being left on the curb. And yes, that does happen. So people that that continually happen to can now be fined with a ticket.
And there'll be photographs taken with a, you know, with a measuring device, so it will be clear that it exceeds this requirement. So
you have to remember, the old way was, if this existed and you're like, oh, this happens all the time, when are we going to do something, it would be in the form of an OTR. But at the same time, an OTR is just really just a phone call to them saying, via a formal reaching out for that property owner, saying, please, you're not allowed to do this. Can you get rid of it? And ultimately, if they're not reached right away, we end up picking it up anyway, and there's no real recourse in the courts because it's gone. And we don't want that anymore. We still may pick it up, but we'll look to recoup the cost of that pickup and the ticket in the court proceedings.
Which it may not go to court. A lot of people are just going to pay the ticket.
Yeah.
But later you'll see we have the ability to actually take action and then charge it back and have it assessed. We put that in Article 3 in the enforcement section.
Great.
Okay, so that's E, the rubbish or the bulk pickup pickup items, sorry. Required recycling. This was a section called newspaper waste. It was kind of a strange provision, which we just said that the title was required recycling, so we just said recycling is mandatory in the Village of Austining and that you have to fully comply with the source separation law. So again, it's another cross-reference to the actual regulations. Item G, this was that additional provision we wanted to just remind owners of the typical takeout type establishments that they have to provide a receptacle near the doorway. So they're not coming out and putting it in the public receptacle on the street, that there has to be a certain amount of responsibility. So just having it present there and available is what we're looking to do. Most of them do, actually. Most of them do. So we're just sort of making it mandatory. This is the supplemental regulations and his notice of Paul's notice of schedule. We always had to provide it and we had to publish it. That's not changing. We're going to be able to do that. The key is 10 days after it's published, it now is enforceable. So we're making sure that that kind of thing can happen. And we're providing reality by using recycling as a separate day. He's entitled to schedule that on a separate day. And then there was a provision in here, which we talked about a little bit on Monday with the guys, that says they can simply refuse to collect rubbish from any one business where it exceeds 100 pounds in weight on a special collection day. So that would be a special collection day would be the bulk pickup day or the recycling day, or if it's more than 100 pounds, they were explaining that if these businesses are on the early part of the route, they're really overfilling the truck, which delays the route being able to be completed on time because there's a certain volume, and so they can leave things behind if they're going to overload the truck. So this was a concern of theirs, and they wanted me to be sure that we didn't remove this from the law. They wanted to be sure that people understood that they could choose to leave this behind if that happens that way. And then you'll see this is the that little last sentence is where this, a superintendent can approve collection of rubbish by special appointment from residential property owners. When you come home from vacation and see that someone has put that mattress on your front yard, you can make a, you can call DPW and make that arrangement, and you're not going to be penalized for that. So that's what that is in that section there. 225.18, we just changed it to reflect the actual math. This is one of those math items I was able to do without actually calling Thomas, and he knows how often I call him through the day. And again, this is the computation of weight can be made by the superintendent or the designee. Again, expanding the ability for people, the list of people who can enforce this. Article 3 was a holdover, a very strange article. At some point, the village must have been a permit, a licensing agent for permits for the transport of noxious kinds of waste. So we left the definitive things in here, but of course the local permit doesn't exist anymore, so we're just telling people they need, they're responsible to get a law, a license from an the applicable licensing agent. And we're also saying you can't bring a truck that's been used for the transport of these things, leave it on your property, and have it be spilling all over. So it's keeping vehicles and the premises clean from the effluent from that, and also the transportation of those materials. And you can't leave it in such a way that it's going to, attract vermin of some kind. So that's in there. Article 4 is the actual enforcement and penalty section. This is the meat of the companion part to that section at the beginning that says the each property owner is responsible for their property. And this is that section which talks about how the violations of the chapter, we clearly spell out here that it's strict liability, and there's no culpable mental state that we need to allege or prove or show. It's just simply that it exists, that you did something you weren't supposed to do, or you didn't do something that you were required to do. And that makes it makes it clear throughout. Now, I did have a question here. I wanted to get some feedback. These violations, as suggested by Deputy Corporation Counsel Hamilton, will need to be tracked in a way, and we believe that we can do that through the Municity program. Now, that just means that Municity will have to be accessible to the individuals who are going to be doing the enforcement. So that's a question that will happen in 225.29 when we talk about who will be able to enforce this. But do you think the penalties should be, the time frame for the cumulative penalties accrual should be this 3-year period? This was something we actually borrowed from another local jurisdiction. We're saying if you get a second violation within a 3-year period, it goes up to another dollar amount. But it seems to me a three-year period is a long period of time. So if what we're trying to do is stop the frequent flyers, as it were, you might want to shorten that time period to some other time frame. So I'm looking at 225-28B, the penalties for offenses. I didn't know, Bill, if you had wanted to weigh in on this as well, because these are the kinds of people who are frequently violating the law, and to say that you'll be paying $150 until the next one that comes 3 years later, I mean, it's...
Well, within 3 years.
Yeah, within 3 years. So I don't know whether you want to leave it that way, or, I mean... I don't know if it's written the way you want it to be written or how you feel about it.
Well, I mean, the other thing is, this is not going to be an electronically written ticket, is it? It's
gonna no,
be
ele- it will
so
have
it's gonna
to
be a handwritten ticket. Aren't we talking about we know who the offenders are? And if they do something this year and they do something a year and a half from now, is that really the pattern? Isn't it more like a one-off, you got something going on in your life, or you're a chronic offender? So
my point, yeah, that's my point.
But I mean, a chronic offender isn't somebody who does something in 2010 and then in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So
you're saying what she's saying.
Yeah, we're saying the same thing.
That's what she's saying. Laura, you're saying 3 years.
So if the second penalty is committed within a...
It
does make sense if you're a chronic offender.
If I can just make one observation. We do have chronic offenders, and I'm going to go out on a limb and say that the chronic offenders in the building department arena are in large part going to be very similar to the group that doesn't have a problem putting the piano out in front of 73 Croton today, because it's now the village's job to take that away and make it not somebody's problem. Here's the thing, though. The prosecutor also has discretion, and there's what we were looking at with the progressive statute was with the really serious problem properties, we want to hold those owners to task and keep their attention, hence the increasing fines. 2010, you get your first violation. 2.5 years later, you go on vacation, and bang, here's your second violation. Someone's dumped a mattress on your property. I would hope the prosecutor has sense enough to actually deal with the defendant as a human being, because it will be glaring. I mean, it's in the building department cases, it's glaring. When they used to write the OTRs on garbage, I got one once. My daughter put the garbage out. She had never put the garbage out before. She put it out too soon. I paid the ticket. It was the one ticket we got for that. She could have done it 3 more times, I suppose. I would hope at that point the prosecutor has enough sense to realize we're not dealing with the recidivist that we're looking at. So the idea is to set the framework for the problem cases down the road, with the understanding that not every recidivist by the second or third time is actually what we're looking at. I mean, things happen. People will goof. People do it with parking. I see them parking all the time. Even though they know that, they say it to me, I know the sign was there, I parked anyway. I forgot. I just, why would I do progressive discipline? They've shown up.
So what, it could be a lot shorter because the chronic offenders are going to do it 3 times in a year. And that's fine. They can do it 3 times in a year, and then it goes up to 1,000, and then it stays at 1,000, like in perpetuity for those people, right?
Right. But the interaction, well, yes. The prosecutor, though, would have some discretion. I mean, theoretically, there will be a conversation with that defendant as to what the underlying facts are. We assuming we have that case, if we have a really serious case where we're not sure if it's a true repeat offender, well, then the deputy's got to call the corp counsel and say, here's what I think I should do with this case. I don't think $1,000 is appropriate, and here's why.
Okay.
It shouldn't be blind application. That's not what we're looking for here.
Okay. All right. I'm comfortable with this.
Okay.
All right.
So we're just leave it the way it is, right?
Right.
Okay.
We can.
There's no need to change it in order to address the egregious offenders that we're trying to address.
Correct. So. Yes. Okay, and we're up to 225-29 enforcement. This is where we mostly need your input. Chapter 5, which is called appearance tickets in your code, already has a list, and I actually transcribed that list, and it's in that second paragraph. It's just it's an asterisk bullet-pointed list. It seems to me we should make this list as broad as possible. However, there should be a department. I think Bill was suggesting a department to take the lead, or in some ways, one or two departments to take the lead. I mean, we're going to have to do a fair amount of follow-up. The service of process is an essential part. So, I don't know what you'd like to do, if you'd like to include other titles or if you'd like to include some more broad language to catch this up. I think you were talking about a dedicated unit of some kind. Those were the words I wrote down from the meeting on Monday when you were on the phone. Name everyone in the list, and in terms of the sort of on the ground process, we can develop that as we go along.
Right. Part of what I was getting at when we were doing the telephone conference was it's possible somebody in the rec department over the weekend, because they happen to be working, comes across something that's very substantial. What I was trying to get at is the list ought to be as broad as we're comfortable with the understanding that there are some pretty strict requirements on our side, which are the ticket has to be written correctly, so somebody has to be trained. And who's going to control the input into Municity? By the way, I brought up Municity because we bought and paid for it, and instead of in a new system, and since the building department cases are already in Municity, this would keep the history for each property together.
Okay.
So instead of having, say, a, you know, DPW's database not linked to the building department, where there may be a relationship, when anybody goes to Municity, whoever that person is, when they call up 16 Croton, oh, look, 52 garbage tickets and 14 building violation cases, all the history's there. So one of the things we're dealing with now is dealing with recidivists, where when we go back and start pulling the files out, you know, we thought there were two prior cases, it turned out to be eight.
Okay. You know. So I said it's a handwritten ticket, but the reality is it is documented in
the
computer.
Well,
and
the database, right, the database will be historical from our perspective. So it should be, I think it should be a broad list, but in the reality, you know, to make this work day to day, it should be fairly narrow because there is a bit of training. And, you know, the, when I said the rec department people, I was just thinking the weekend employees might be the first responder, if you will. And we don't want to wait till Monday.
Paul?
We get a lot of calls. I get a lot of calls from you guys when there's stuff put out there on a Sunday morning and when people
pictures.
Are driving around. Yeah, pictures too, texts.
You like my pictures, don't you?
First of all, the piano's gone, the aforementioned piano. It's back into the parcel. And hopefully we put out on the appropriate bulk day. Thank you, Lynn, for that texted update. secondly, with regard to this, yes, I concur that the more people you put here, the merrier. But in the infancy of this new approach, or really the resurrection of the old approach, because we have a documented ticket receiver in the room, it might blossom into that. But I think right now, with the fact that we have the police on here and code enforcement who are on call 24/7, we'll be able to handle those issues with actual ticketed results. And again, we'll feel better knowing that if it's something that we can't get an immediate touch with the owner because they're away or they're not answering or they're an absentee landlord, we can come and document it, collect it, ticket them, and essentially, if we want it to come off the road, still pick it up and get it out of the way so we don't have the...
police officer and code enforcement makes perfect sense, especially because police officers are 24/7. So I like that very much for them to be well aware of how this process will work. But really, it's the sanitation department. We don't want sanitation foreman to be one. I mean, I know there's like this long list. We're going to take that long list
out. All Department of Public Works foreman includes a sanitation foreman.
And so we are keeping this whole list?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, I thought you were just going to do like...
My request was to put this list in and then pad it with other things that you think appropriate.
But shouldn't we have...
Us? I mean, who's not on this list? Jeez.
I mean, do we have a housing inspector?
No, but maybe we will.
It doesn't matter. They're making a list to cover bases, so they might have...
We don't have a superintendent of public works. We don't, you know...
Putting in
a
list.
That will not only lives today, but into the future.
Right.
So we could have people with those prospective titles going forward at some point.
Just put everybody.
It just seems strange to me. Why don't we? Why we didn't use some more broad language? You know, as you know, referring to the departments and people directed by those departments.
Well,
to be
I was
able
wondering
to
why
we can do it that way. That would be
a
great way to do it.
I would think that you know, at the discretion of the village manager, you know, other titles could be added to this list to perform that function based on training. I mean, that would seem to make more sense to me than. Not that this list is necessarily limiting, it's fairly expansive, but you know, maybe you're better served by giving discretion to the village manager to decide.
So perhaps we can do a combination of what the mayor suggests and what you're suggesting. We can say the various departments who have authority, or you know, the designees of the department chair persons, and including the village manager. So
and the police department.
Yeah, we can say the police department, the sanitation department, the Department of Public Works, the Parks and Recreation department. That you know, we can do it broadly as the departments, and then indicate
the designees of the supervisors.
The designees of the designees of the supervisors of the various departments, and then we can also say, or a designee of the village manager, as may be appropriate to the circumstances.
You got a funny look on your face, Paul.
No, I just. I think we talked about that enough. We just move along.
We came to a different conclusion. We just changed all the how we're listing
yeah,
it. Are
yeah,
you
that's
okay
good.
With that?
Yeah.
So we'll list the departments. Basically, you're saying everyone except I think the person who cleans the bathrooms or something. It's like it's everyone in that list.
Yeah, except that we're not listing.
Oh no, actually they could be designated. That's right.
But we're not listing obsolete titles.
No, I understand. Yeah. I think you should do, I mean, I think you guys
We need to write that. Whatever we need to write so when someone contests a ticket or decides to take it to court, can't say
someone had the authority to write the ticket.
Authorized to write the ticket.
Right. So whatever we have to write to say that, that's what we need to do.
Okay, and so then there's just training on how to document and so that it stands up in court if it's taken to court, right? That's the whole deal.
Yeah, the idea is they're going to pay the fine, fix the problem, but if they challenge it, we have to be able to justify.
And the tickets have to be written properly in the first place. Right. So all the people that are designated will be trained before they go out and do
That's the training, it. Right? The training is to write, to create the right tickets, write them correctly so that they're able to stand up in court.
So maybe we could take a look at it and list the departments and then the designees, and I will do that.
Thank you.
Great, thank you. And then at a minimum, I just put in a section reminding the public that this is a notice of strict liability violation, and then it just has to have a list of the violations complained of with specific reference to provisions and sections of the chapter. Again, that's going to be part of the training when people start to write these tickets. A summary of the facts supporting the violation, total amount of the fine or fines has to be on the face, and also instructions on how to pay the fine, which is key. So we'll have to determine those rules and procedures as we move forward. And also pointing out, this was at Bill's suggestion, that you always have the ability, since you're right there, you're on the street, this mess occurs, you don't know who the property owner is, so you can write it as you would write when there's been a criminal violation. It's the same kind of thing. You can write it to John or Jane Doe as the property owner. And then when you serve it by certified mail, then you'll have done the research and you know where to send it. Does that meet what you wanted it to meet, that section? And then the procedure for serving notices, you always have the right to serve it personally to the property owner. And that's as much as you need to do. Or if you're there and the property owner isn't there, you leave it with a person of age of majority and suitable authority, or you post it conspicuously if you can't determine that there's somebody there that meets that criteria. And you then have to send it by first-class certified registered mail, return receipt requested. Thank you, the United States Mail. And then where there's a determination that the superintendent feels it's a nuisance, or it's in the public thoroughway and it's obstruction, they're going to be able to take that extra step to do it overnight mail or deliver by overnight courier. So,
what's and the one referring to? In C? It's a C and then one? Is there a two?
Or affixed and this should be two. Thank you. Two. Shall be mailed to the property owner via overnight mail. That's just sort of an expedited process for those circumstances which are egregious or noxious or nuisance, public nuisance related. And then there's further action upon noncompliance. This is without the intent. This is the ability where they're going to determine there's a nuisance or a danger, and we're going to be able to take action, and then we're going to be able to assess it against the property owners. John, I think we talked about this the last time, and you were talking about stepping up the process if it were a nuisance or a health concern, and the superintendent or designee can determine that, and we can move a lot quicker. And then we can cause it to be removed, and then we can assess it against the property owner. And therein lies the changes.
Okay.
Thank you for your patience.
Yes, and I want to say for anybody who's following at home, they know exactly how long we've been talking about this, and it may have seemed rather laborious. But I want to thank all the departments who worked on this, the legal department, both Lori Lee and John Hamilton, the building department, the DPW sanitation guys. We just keep calling them guys. It's Mike Duffy and
Mike Perry.
Perry, yeah. I know both instrumental in going through this for on-the-job experience, and of course, Paul, and now all of the board weighing in on this. And the reason we spend so much time on it is because this is a really important issue for our quality of life, for supporting the success of our businesses, for all of us, for sanitation, for the our property values, how we experience our community. So I really do appreciate us moving this forward, and whatever we need to do to get in on an agenda. I assume we have to call for a public hearing or something.
Yes. Did you want me to make the changes that one, two, three, or do you want me to just do that in due course and still put it on for a public hearing? I can put it on for resolution calling for a public hearing.
Yeah, you can definitely do that. Yeah. Let's do that.
You can. You're always entitled to make the changes up until the point
right.
you vote on it.
So we'll call for a designation. Yep. So next week we'll call for a public hearing so we can move this forward. Something I'd like to see in place as soon as possible. Thanks
I'll
so
put
much.
It on. Great. Thank you. Thank you for your patience.
Feel very well informed now.
The devil's in the details.
The devil's in the details. Okay, the last item is actually tax certiorari's, and Thomas is here with the documentation. Thank you. I have two resolutions drafted. I've already provided them to Joseph to put on for next week. These are in due course. There are two properties. One is at 7375-77 Spring Street, and one is at 160 South Highland Avenue. The South Highland Avenue property, one qualified for a reduction of $7,155.80. The property, the combined property on Spring Street, qualified for $24,839.12. So these, as you know, are settlements. They are reached by the town attorney, and we have very little to say about it. So I have these drafted up. They'll be on your agenda for next week.
Super. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Tom.
Tom, I texted him. I said, can you bring it up? Thank you.
Tom, please join us. Would you like to comment on these?
I would. Good evening, Mayor, members of the Board of Trustees. I would actually like to give you some good news about our tax certiorari claims. This year, when we adopted the budget, we thought that the outstanding tax certiorari claims would be $400,000 to be funded by a serial bond. We have not presented a bond resolution to the board because we don't anticipate having to issue a bond, because the bond that we issued last year in 2015 for $550,000 has been carried over to this year because some of the tax certiorari claims got delayed, some of them just dried up, some of them were negotiated for less. So all these tax certiorari claims this year, which, you know, it is a lot of money. It totals about $167,000 so far this year, but that's all being absorbed by the serial bond that was issued last year.
Nice.
And we still have a little bit of money left here that should be more than enough to pay the balance of any claims that come forth for the balance of the year.
So it's like the whole year of certiorari has never happened.
It happened because we have to put money in the budget to pay for the bond last year, but it's good that the amount that we've had to borrow has been significantly reduced.
It's great.
So
thank
you,
Tom.
The 167, that's all the certiorari's to date for this year?
For 2016, yes.
Yes, the running rate.
Okay. Thank you.
And we did have a late arriving item. Thomas had asked to put on an issue because he's finally been able to, after several weeks of working hard, he's been able to allow for payments by credit card. So we'll need to notify the public about the convenience fee. Thomas, do you want to?
Yes, it's been a long time coming, but we actually have the one machine set up in our office already, and we're trying to change some of the names on the devices so that when people get the credit card statements, you know, we'll be able to track it back to which ones come from building department, you know, which one from clerk and such like that. So that's some administrative things. But there is a 3% convenience fee, and we've been terming it a convenience fee when we talk to the, getting ready to talk to people about coming in and paying for credit card transactions because state law doesn't allow us to absorb the fee. So it's actually going to be a double transaction. Their credit card is going to be swiped for the amount of the transaction, and then it's going to be automatically added as a separate credit card receipt for the 3% additional convenience fee. And even though it's not really a fee to us, you know, it's not revenue generating, we're just passing on the charge that's being charged to the village by the bank processing company. We did want to include it in the fee schedule as a resolution just so that the village is actually agreed that this is a charge that should be paid by the customer. You know, it seemed to give it a little bit more strength that we're not just adding on an amount to these transactions, that we are just passing along the charge from the bank processing company.
Thank you for that explanation.
So we're going to put a resolution on, we can provide the specific language on where it will go. So Marion will know how to revise that, but it'll be on for next week.
Can I just clarify? And this is to allow you to accept credit card payments in village offices. Can you do it over the phone?
Yes, we are allowed to take payments over the phone. We've had training on what the protocol is. And in fact, we had somebody called today, and we had a discussion in our group, in our office, to make sure that, like, you know, we get the person's name, you know, we find out what the card is, get their phone number in case that there's a problem and such. But, you know, it does work by entering the numbers in over the keypad. You know, and then entering the additional verifying information that the transactions do go through.
And you could do online as well?
We're not there yet, but when we had the training last week, you know, I looked at this as step one, and I asked our contact with the bank processing company to please talk to us about how we can take online payment. So that's the very next step.
Excellent. Look forward to that. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
We're done.
Thank you, Tom. That was one of Tom's measurable goals this year, and he's accomplished that. So good job, Tom. Tax certiorari settlements.
Did it?
It was done when I was out in the hallway there with Bill. And I could just draw your attention to two upcoming resolutions in next week's meeting. The first being the annual snow and ice agreement that we execute with the state for our maintenance of Route 9 during the winter months. And the second is a POMCO amendment, which is going to be appended by Linda McMahon's presentation, but some the execution of some documents associated with our health care coverage.
Okay. Nothing more to say on it?
Yeah, you're just.
You said we're going to discuss it with Linda McMahon during the. I mean, I don't want to. Is there anything we need to know before she discusses it with us in the budget?
Well, I can tell you, I'm having some ongoing conversations with her with regard to our healthcare provider, and we're doing some checks and balances and some possible alternative approaches. But this really hasn't furthered along. So this might be amended a little bit next week, but this is what's planned on being on right now.
Okay. And there's a reason it has to be on at this time?
Because
Yeah. Assuming that we stick with the status quo, this needs to be passed.
Yeah.
In the short time frame.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Is there anything else I don't know about that's on the agenda? We're ready to adjourn the meeting. Okay. With that, thank you very much to everyone for your stick-to-itiveness. And this was an in-depth and productive meeting in a different way than we've had recently. Please join us for our next meeting, which will be a legislative session at the Birdsall Fagan Police Court facility on September 21st, as always at 7:30. I would like a motion to adjourn to
executive session.
We're going for advice to counsel. We don't have to adjourn for that, but executive session for discussion of personnel regarding specific persons.
So moved.
Second.
On the board. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, with that, thank you very much. Join us next week. This meeting is adjourned.